Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of VHS Era. Today, I am joined by another special guest who is all that. I am, of course, talking to the second all that cast member I've had on this show, Angelique Bates. Thanks for coming on, Angelique.
Hey, thank you for having me.
Now, last time, I had actually pitched 8 Crazy Nights to Lisa Foyles, and she agreed to be on. She agreed to do her episode on that. But this time, Angelique pitched The Fifth Element to me. Now, just out of curiosity, Angelique, why did you pitch The Fifth Element?
Wow, it actually has sentimental value. My late aunt, she introduced me to a lot of movies. With Bruce Willis, the old Beverly Hills Cops, those kind of movies, Westerns, and Fifth Element was even the futuristic ones. Like, she was the one that was just always about the movies, and Fifth Element was one that she used to play all the time on the VHS. And I just remember, those moments that I used to spend with her at her house and watching the movies and her doing the air popcorn and everything. And when I did finally see the movie, I just fell in love with it because of Chris Tucker, which is kind of interesting. It seemed like that movie, well, obviously, if it's about the future, it was ahead of its time.
Yeah. So, were you a big Chris Tucker fan?
Oh yes, very much so.
What?
I love Chris Tucker. I actually met him one time in the mall, and I tried not to fan out. I did a really good job, but I tried not to fan out.
It's funny. You say you met him at the mall, because this is like one of 4 times he did a movie with Tiny Lister. And the first time was not Friday, which is what many people would think it was. It was actually The Meteor Man. Because, yes, Chris Tucker has a small part in that movie as a guy who's introducing Meteor Man at the mall. So that's kind of a funny coincidence.
It is, and it's funny that you mentioned Tiny because my children used to have play dates with his daughter.
Oh, it's cool.
Yeah, he was a great spirit.
Yeah, actually, I produced a show he was on, not a like a TV show, a podcast interview show that he did before his unfortunate passing back in 2020. I think it might have been the last like podcast he was on. So, but like to be less morbid, like how many times did your kids have play dates with his daughter?
A while. We knew each other for about a couple years. I had met him and his wife at the time at an event. I'm like, what was it? I think it was like a gifting suite or something. And met his daughter and found out that I had a daughter and son. And we actually stayed not too far from each other. So we were just like, hey, why don't you come over? And we would go to movies, we would hang out, holidays, birthdays. It was fun.
Yeah. Did you ever say, oh, I used to watch you all the time in The Fifth Element?
I kept pretty, regular. No fanning out.
All right,
But
that's
I
good.
will say a cute moment that me and him did have at the gifting, because Friday was one of the movies that I loved with him in it. He in the picture, which I posted before, he actually does like how he did them, and he has the picture where he's like, and I'm like this. So it kind of like went back on the whole little Friday thing.
Okay, cool. So then anyway, actually, before we look at the VHS openings, like in your career in the arts, like how many how many parents have you had where you've either like acted with them in things or like knew them from things, like just out of curiosity?
Oh my gosh, I would prove to me that I can't count because a lot of the ones that are my peers are, well, we're parents now or married or something. So it's like now we've worked with each other. Our kids are now growing up with each other. There's been situations where, which is actually funny, my son is actually in Usher's New Look program. And he was he's been in it for like a few years. And it was funny because one of my other buddies was hosting one of the events, and I was just like, that's so crazy that everything is like coming back, you know, full circle. And I was telling my son, he was like, really? You know him? And I was just like, okay, well, we used to work together, you know, and you know, I said, we've seen each other a couple of times. Like when he sees me, it's all love. It's we know each other. It's not one of those, oh, I know so and so, that they don't remember who you are. So my son was just like ecstatic about that. And I was like, it's crazy how it's just with our kids, it's like now he's sitting there, he's looking out for all of Atlanta, all the children, he's doing great things in the community. And then my son is in one of the programs.
Awesome. So anyway, let us now look at the VHS openings for The Fifth Element.
In every age, there is a cause worth fighting for. But in the future, the greatest threat to our survival will not be man at all.
What's going on?
War! We're going to war!
Now the youth of tomorrow must travel across the stars to defend our world.
We are a generation commanded by fate to defend humankind.
Everyone fights, no one quits.
We are going in with first wave. You smash the entire area. You kill anything that has more than two legs. You get me?
We get you, sir!
But they will face an enemy more devastating than any ever imagined.
Here it comes! Ah!
Incoming!
Mayday, mayday, this is Rock 92.
We're under attack, sir. We need retrieval now.
Someone made a damn mistake.
Bugs laid a trap for us, didn't they?
This fall, TriStar Pictures takes you to the front lines of the next frontier.
Kill them all!
Starship Troopers.
I really liked Starship Troopers when I saw it. The movie doesn't really capture its like kind of quirky satirical tone, but that's almost kind of perfect that it doesn't, and it makes it look like it's going to be like a normal action blockbuster, because it kind of fits almost like with the spirit of the movie in a way.
Yeah.
You know, what did you think of that trailer?
Wow, that took me back to a period where everything just seemed so simple. And just like the littlest things just put us in awe, because I thought Starship Troopers was like, oh wow, you know, they're in space and they're fighting. Like I thought it was like so awesome. You know, as we're older, it's kind of like what you just said, it's kind of like, okay. I mean, it was cool when we first saw it. And that was another movie that my aunt made sure that I was able to go see. So just the moments with the VHS and just the, I think Starship Troopers, around that time, that was what was Star Wars. We were still off of, you know, the Star Treks and everything. So it was just it fell all into that category, you know? But I think as kids, we didn't really kind of like realize some of the cheesiness with the way things were shot. Because if you put it on the scale of Star Wars and Star Trek, it doesn't beat it, you know? But it was just kind of like, oh, cool. This is something that seems a little bit more up to age and, you know, and everything. So that was my outlook on it.
I killed Boom Boom. And I cannot make myself feel bad about it. I cannot imagine a god who would care.
I have to warn you, not just about the physical danger, because he's already killed one prisoner and crippled another, but also McCabe is very sharp.
Right. You know why I'm here. My son will die without a transplant.
And somehow, I was identified as a genetic match with your son.
It's what I've been told.
Maybe you can appreciate my amusement at the irony. After all those years being locked up, I'm given the opportunity to kill again. Cop's kid at that. All I gotta do is stay right here.
Well, that's not acceptable.
Matt is not gonna die.
We won't give up hope.
Transplant's gonna go down. The governor okayed.
The only reason he would ever agree to do this is because he's planning to escape. Let him believe he can.
Let's give him the Demerol right away. It'll put him under.
Is he out?
It's not dropping. I don't understand. He's not responding.
Something went really wrong, didn't it?
Yes, it did.
This is Peter McCabe speaking. I'm in charge here.
How did he do that?
He's smart, and he's got us exactly where he wants us.
Appreciate my work, Frank.
The governor wants you to bring in the SWAT team.
You kill him, you kill my son!
How many more people are gonna have to die tonight so that kid can live?
We're a team, Frankie. You begin to see that now. We've been a team since the day I met you.
You want to test my resolve, Frank? My willingness to go the limit? You want to find out where you stop and I begin? Do you, Frank?
So the first half of that trailer kind of looks interesting. Save your son's life, knowing that this that the only man who could save him is like this dangerous criminal, would you? And then it kind of just looks like it turns into a generic thriller. So it kind of almost looks like it just sort of takes what could have been like an interesting premise and turns it into like Die Hard in a hospital. And look, I really like Die Hard, but it's like everything needs to be Die Hard but in a blank. But it looks okay.
I don't even remember that movie.
Yeah.
But I kind of felt that like it pulled me in because Michael Keaton. I mean, if you saw Michael Keaton, you saw the TriStar logo, it's like you knew it was going to be a good movie. Like it was something that was going to bring you in. But it kind of lost me towards, like, you know, when we got past a couple of minutes, it's like, oh, okay, this looks like it's about to be cliche. You know, like all the other movies that were coming out that they might have been trying to copy after, like the Die Hards and the Terminators and all that. It's just like, how many of the same concept are you going to do, but just with different actors?
Yeah, I will say that I'm, you know, watching Succession now, so it was kind of distracting whenever Brian Cox showed up. It's like, oh, it's Logan Roy.
Right. Yeah, that's crazy.
And he's basically looking like he's playing Logan Roy.
Right, that is wild. So it's funny as we go back in time, and now they're like on current. Yeah, I can see that.
TriStar Pictures, Amblin Entertainment, and the director of GoldenEye. In a land where freedom is a memory and justice is outlawed, the just must become outlaws.
Okay, after a looking trailer, they redeemed themselves there. That actually, you know, I've never seen, I, you know, it's weird. I saw The Legend of Zorro, the sequel, because it was like for a middle, like the, what is it, the local newspaper asked kids to like do articles for their kids' day section, and I had to do a review on The Legend of Zorro. So I've seen The Legend of Zorro, And that was almost 20 years ago. I never got around to The Mask of Zorro, but that trailer actually did make it look really cool and badass. The only thing I'll say is the score at the end was a little too close to the Pirates of the Caribbean score. Which made me think, oh, is there some plagiarism going on here? Or is, I don't know if Hans Zimmer was the one who did the music for that movie or just that trailer, if he was reusing a score from The Mask of Zorro. So that made me feel a little eh, but otherwise that was a cool trailer.
Antonio Banderas. I was such a fan of Antonio Banderas. I still am. I love his work. So I was already geeked about that. I love horses. I have my own horse and everything. So it kind of was just like, it was just fun. And it was like, well, he's a hero. He's saving people. He saves a beautiful woman. So I was kind of like into, like, I just like that kind of stuff. And like I said, Antonio Banderas was in it. The score, that is actually a great observation. It's very possible that it did get recycled. Probably have to see like who actually did the score for Zorro and then look at the Pirates of the Caribbean, because I hear that all the time, especially in the licensing and in the music world, that they'll go back and they'll take little things, or it might actually be part of their licensing and they probably just didn't think anybody would notice, because it's like, who would remember that?
In 1977, a motion picture astounded us.
Ares 31, do you wish to report a UFO?
It challenged us. It dazzled us. It took our breath away. From the brilliant imagination of writer-director Steven Spielberg, the masterpiece that started it all. Now, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, the Collector's Edition, featuring an exclusive making-of retrospective with new interviews and never-before-seen footage. An all-new experience. A journey you'll never forget. Close Encounters of the Third Kind, the Collector's Edition, written and directed by Steven Spielberg.
So Close Encounters is honestly one of those movies that I've heard of. I know, at least the ending. I'll admit I've actually never seen it, but that was a pretty, just decent this like trailer helping to sort of sell this movie, like, the score, like the like it didn't feel like it was just like, here you go. Here's Close Encounters. It was sort of just like more remember Close Encounters. He like remember these iconic shots and how it's from Steven Spielberg. I could see that. Even it doesn't say a whole lot about the movie, other than it's about aliens, but it's a fine sort of collector's edition thingy trailer.
Well, I don't remember seeing the movie. I feel like I might have seen parts of it because of my aunt, because like I said, she was so into that stuff. So I'm pretty sure I saw it. That looked like one of those movies that probably was very long. So I probably fell asleep or was like doing something else. It's definitely very, Spielberg, and that was like the height of everything, the thriller and all that other stuff. So Spielberg, you already know it was going to just be an awesome movie, but I think that fell already into the futuristic. It was the typical, but he was like the top of the food chain with it. So it's just like, he, not saying that he did it first, but it was just like up there with it. So it's like, if it came out Close Encounters, boom, you already know it was hot. I think because of my age, I just don't remember it. But when they said 1977, I know that that's not when it was. That's what they were, saying in the script. It just sounds so prehistoric when you said that.
Yeah, but I will say it is kind of smart that they had like this one like trailer for like an iconic sci-fi movie preceded before this other sci-fi movie. It's almost like if you like this classic, stay for our movie almost.
Yes.
Zalmi should have been a star.
The kid's a genius.
But there were complications. Benny could have been famous, but life got in the way.
Well, it ain't no use to sin, wonder why, babe.
Tony had a brush with success.
You the one who writes the songs?
Don't you know I'm nothing without you?
But had to let it go.
I want you to play one of my songs.
So it was up to Pete to grab it, hold it, and make himself heard.
Working on a night move, trying to make some front page driving news. Working on a night move.
One family.
It's the music I love.
Four generations.
This isn't work. This is play.
In love with the sound of American pop. Ralph Bakshi, the creator of Fritz the Cat and Lord of the Rings, now takes modern animation a quantum leap forward with a motion picture of incredible beauty and remarkable power.
Don't you want somebody to love? Don't you need somebody to love? Don't you love somebody to love? You better find somebody to love.
Whether you dance to it, drive to it, sing with it, or swing with it. If you can crank it up, plug it in, or switch it on, if it assaults your senses, rocks your body, or touches your soul, it's American pop.
So I'm not sure there's like a whole lot of audience overlap between this and Fifth Element, but the animation is neat, and I'm a sucker for showbiz stories. So that is a movie that I wouldn't mind watching. It looks like it could be kind of cool.
You're right. Well, I don't remember that movie at all.
I think it's from the early 80s.
Yeah, I could believe that. So I was like, I mean, it definitely seems cool. It reminded me very Disney-ish, like, you know, Princess and the Frog kind of, not the animation, because obviously the animation was more advanced by the time Princess and the Frog came around. But it's kind of amazing to see what we thought was cool back then. We were just like, oh, because you could even hear the narrator just like, yeah, you know, animation and blah blah, like it was supposed to be so amazing back then, but like now you look at what we have now and just see how far we've come, it's just like wow. But it definitely did seem intriguing, just to definitely like look, because I love animation, I love musicals, and you know, so it's, you know, it seemed like it would be something, you know, interesting to look at with my kids.
Yeah, but I don't know if it's really a kids movie. It looks like a more of an adult animated film, but but I will say that, you know, funny you mentioned that you loved animation, because I remember there was one episode of All That, like I think in the period you came out, you were on, right, where they like reused a clip from Ren and Stimpy. Like, what was your reaction to that?
Wow, it's so funny. My one of my kids is like almost 17, so that's why I said I would watch with him. So I wouldn't probably watch it with anyone younger. But the Ren and Stimpy, it was so funny because back then, we were seeing so much stuff, but I don't think we were really grasping, you know, like maybe this might not be appropriate, you know. But you got to think about the songs that we had on the show too, so that filter, it just wasn't there. I think we were just like, oh, okay, Ren and Stimpy. But it's like now, when we're older, it's kind of like, wow, we really left that on there. You know, it does hit differently now.
Yeah. I don't remember if it was actually a skit you were on. I think it, from my vague recollections, it was like maybe a skit with Josh and Kel, and then for a second, like they showed a reaction of Ren and Stimpy screaming, and I was like, oh, was that just Ren and Stimpy?
I think it was one of theirs. I think it was. I feel like I remember which scene it was, but it was just that, that was the network. It was just so much stuff that just flew. Whoosh. Now if you try it nowadays, it's like, nope. Cancel culture and all that.
When extraterrestrials get out of control, there's only one solution.
We'll take it from here.
Tommy Lee Jones, Will Smith.
Put your hands on your head.
Is that better? This summer.
There's only one way off of this planet, baby. And that's through me.
They're protecting the Earth from the scum of the universe.
You're doing fine, Ace.
Men in Black.
Don't ever, ever touch that red button.
Rated PG-13.
That was like the last trailer, and that is also smart to put another hit sci-fi movie of theirs on there after, it's like, and at the very end too, it's like, before you watch this hit sci-fi film from this year, watch this. Oh, remember, we have this, we also own this. Well,
You're right.
buy this other sci-fi film that we own that's a hit. And yeah, I think that trailer, though quick, does a good job of selling Men in Black how they wanted to, as a fun sci-fi comedy.
Yeah, I agree. I enjoyed Men in Black. That was definitely Tommy the I forget Tommy. No, what was his name? Yeah, Tommy. Tommy and Will Smith. Like I loved them together and just in separate films. But Men in Black was just like, oh, this is so cool. 'Cause like you said, it was like down the comedy to us. But back then, that's when we had the Blockbusters. So to do those trailers like that, it's like, okay, so when you're going back and taking your VHS, it's like, oh, let me go and get that one. Because it would always, the way they did the trailers, if you remember, if we went to the, the shelves or whatever, they had it lined up like that too. So you're like, oh, okay, well, this is the one that was in the trailer. Let me go ahead and grab that one. You're going back and get your popcorn and your candy or whatever, back home.
Yeah, I will just say, I'm surprised they didn't put the trailer for Godzilla, like the Godzilla, the Matthew Broderick one on here, because I don't love that movie, but you'd think, I know they were really trying to push that movie, and it's also from Sony, so you'd think they would have put it on here, which is surprising that they didn't.
Yeah, no, that's right. That was another good call. Yeah, you would think that they just would have, if they were, grabbing the big ones and what they were trying to get attention, you'd think they would have put it on. I wonder why. Actually, I would have put that probably instead of the cartoon.
Yeah, either instead of the cartoon or instead of the Die Hard with Michael Keaton movie.
Well, he was like the top guy around this, so that's probably why they did that. Because that was definitely like the, for me, I think that, I feel like that was the height of his career. That I see why they did that, because it's like you see Michael Keaton, it's like, oh, it's got to be an awesome movie until you look at the trailer.
Yeah, but now it is time to rate the previews with stay through the previews or skip to the feature. And again, besides the Michael Keaton movie, this was a fun set of previews, so I would say stay through the previews.
Yeah, I would say stay through the previews. The Michael Keaton was definitely, but I feel like Michael Keaton would have still like, I didn't realize the trailer kind of sucked until after it was over. But the animation did throw me because I felt like it shouldn't have been in that mix.
Yeah, I mean, it was
But
an odd
just,
fit.
yeah, but stay.
Yeah, it was an odd fit for like that specific, for these specific list of trailers, but on its own, it was still like a decent trailer. Maybe because it is such kind of a bizarre looking movie, it's like they didn't know where to put it. Like, again, it looked too, like you couldn't put it on a kid's, like a trailer for like a kid's
Oh
movie
yeah,
because
not a straight kids movie.
Yes, but so they know it's like, what do we put this with?
Yeah, because that's almost like with any kind of anime. It's like it's some, depending on the age of your child, will watch it. But it's like you can't straight just put it on a Disney or, you know, whatever, Chipmunks or something like that. So yeah, I guess they probably just kind of like threw it in there because you're not going to put it on a trailer with dramas
Yeah.
or thrillers or something. So I guess where would you put it? Actually, it would make sense to do Fifth Element because of the comedy twist. And it was kind of like, you know, I guess it would have been the safest bet if you really think about that. That or maybe a Men in Black, because we would have had to see what the trailers were for a Men in Black.
Yeah. But anyway, Angelique, thanks again for coming on to the show again. So, do you have anything to plug?
You know what? Just come to my website, angeliquebates.com. I have been doing a lot of stand-up. I just was at the Laughing Skull out here in Atlanta. Been at Laugh Factory, Hollywood comedy show. So, you know, I'm back doing stand-up. I'm working on a few projects. Working with music. I have, you know, Apple Music. So just go ahead and check me out. I worked on a song with Latangela Newsome from Nickelodeon's Tyena. It was actually her song, and Leon from All That. We both featured on it with her. It was a holiday song. So just, you know, angeliquebates.com or come to my Instagram and you'll find out everything that you need to know.
So anyway, that was our episode on the Fifth Element. And next time, we are following it up with two blockbusters, actually from the 80s and 90s. The first Tim Burton Batman movie and Batman Forever. We'll see you then, everyone.
In the night of